Right. I've been instructed to start. So welcome, everybody. Thank you for taking the time. I'd like to begin by thanking the Dubai Future Foundation for this, just bringing us all together in such an interesting manner. And just briefly, before I kind of jump into the introduction, I remember when this museum was being built, and it was really fascinating growing up in the city to see this structure come out in the middle of the in the middle of the highway. And in the very beginning, I thought it was a building of some sort, and I had this kind of clash with the building. I couldn't really absorb it emotionally as it reshaped the landscape of my city. But I've come to realize after a while that, similar to the Eiffel Tower or the Statue of Liberty, it's a sculpture, and it's meant to project an image to the world of some sort, and that image is an image of possibility, an image of the future, resonated in this kind of structure. But more importantly, I'm happy that the building is used for events such as this, because in the end, I think it's about interaction, it's about the exchange of ideas, it's about coming together, and I think as an active building, it really makes me feel that it's contributing positively not only to the city, but to humanity in general. So I'm incredibly glad that this building has that function. But more specifically, I really like that this building is cladded with poetry and cladded with a cultural vernacular that takes, you know, a people who are nomadic by nature. So our material culture, our material value is not in objects and buildings historically, but in words. And these words are transferred intergenerationally as forms of cultural exchange, which then get practiced as tradition, which brings us together collectively. So I'm really happy that this building has been able to manifest these ideas in some form. So just to kind of, that's the pretext. Thank you, Cornelius and Stephen, Richard, sorry, for joining us today. I usually have my phone for these things. But I'll begin briefly contextualizing this discussion in the UAE, and more particularly Dubai. And I started with a thought a week and a half ago when looking at a picture of G20 leaders. And when you look at the picture of G20 leaders, 19 people are more or less wearing suits. And you'll find one person wearing a kendora. What does that mean when you look at that picture? And 19 people are more or less visually kind of assimilated, homogenized in some form, but yet one person still wears this and presents their ideas in a contemporary fashion. It's an interesting image to analyze. And fundamentally what it means is that this region was kind of held historically in a kind of suspension until the discovery of oil. And as a consequence of this, economic development was so rapid that the cultural transformation was not able to catch up with the West. So you kind of had this really interesting balance where a retention of tribal society, a retention of tribal identity was maintained in tandem with economic development. So maybe hold that image in mind, perhaps, and then quickly I'll transition into two brief thoughts, which is, I was in Japan. I went to see the fabric makers of this kendora, because it's so interesting to really yet still retain this. And the fabric makers called Toyobo in Osaka. And I sat with them and I said, why are you the largest manufacturer of this fabric that is sold to the Gulf? Because it's polyester, that's why they're always clean and not wrinkled. So they're about 80% polyester. And he said, do you know that you're wearing a dinosaur? I said, how am I wearing a dinosaur? And he said, we import oil in the form of pellets. And we use these pellets to make PET bottles. And then these PET bottles are recycled, through which we make polyester and sell you your oil back as forms of clothing. So as you see all of these people wearing kendoras, it's actually, we are literally wearing our material heritage in society. And as I begin transitioning into the story, I just want to say that both my brother and I are on the World Economic Forum committee for looking at the future of housing. And there's one concept as we look at the crisis of global housing, which is a major issue that we're facing around the world, that there are nuances of tradition and heritage that can be learned from and transferred. More particularly, the concept that we have in Arabia called the Majlis, which Dariush has visited many times. Usually within a private household, there is this space that is semi-public, that every house opens to communities. And everyone holds a time and a day to sit with community members where they interact with ideas and share celebrations, weddings, Eid, etc. And they are a form of community repair. They're a form of societal regeneration. And these are the ideas from the past that can be possibly transferred into our future heritage. And what are these mortars that bind our societal bricks together? So without too much introduction, I just wanted to make this contextual preface and hand it over to Cornelius.
Thank you very much for the introduction. Let's move to the first image. So my name is Cornelius Holtorf, and I hold a UNESCO chair on heritage futures. And Richard will say a few words about himself at the next picture. So what is heritage futures? Now normally, heritage as you understand it is what we inherit from the past. Now heritage futures is what we leave behind. It's the legacy we leave behind for the future. And that future can be really distant from today. Now this is one of the kind of sites that we are working with. This is an image showing the plans for the repository of nuclear waste in Sweden. And this is a site that will need to be kept safe for 100,000 years into the future. So this is a really long-term future. And we've been working with the nuclear waste management industry for over 10 years now, both nationally in Sweden, but also internationally through the Nuclear Energy Agency at the OECD in Paris. Now the engineers there are lots of clever engineers, of course, involved in the construction of these sites, and they take into account all the science that they can get hold of. But what they all agree on is that the difficulty in managing nuclear waste is not the geology, it's not the physics, it's people's behavior. It's what will people do with this in the future, in thousands of years ago, possibly. That's the one thing they cannot handle. So that's how we come in, because by education I'm an archaeologist, now specializing in the future. And when we arrived, we said, look, if we look back at how things have changed over time, then the one thing we can say is that it changes in unpredictable ways. And that's not news to futurists. You cannot, the future is uncertain, and the longer you go ahead, even here most people talk about a few decades in the future. Now here we talk centuries or millennia in the future. So we need to embrace change, we need to work with change, not against change. Not trying to preempt what they're going to do and what they're going to think people in the future, but we need to give them the opportunity to make their own stories, their own value system, to regenerate their own frameworks of meaning in the context of these sites. And of course, that doesn't make the task any easier, but maybe it makes the solutions a little bit more realistic. So these are the issues we're dealing with, and that's why we argue that the future needs to be explicitly cultural. It needs to take into account that people have different value systems, they make sense of the world in different ways, they have different identities in the future. Even what it means to be a human being or a member of a certain community will change in the future, just as it has changed in the past. So here we're talking about a very long-term future at a global scale. Many countries have nuclear power and many more are affected by the outputs of nuclear power through industry and so on. And if we think about how to manage the long term, we need to embrace change and we need to challenge our assumption that the future will resemble the present. And these are, of course, some of the key themes of futures literacy that we're working with through UNESCO. So this is my introduction to the theme through this image. Do you want to add something?
No, fantastic. I love that. It's the reach that gets me. And I think the importance of thinking about culture in this context is that by the time this waste, the lifespan you're looking at is long enough for language to have changed utterly. If you speak English, the linguistic structures that you use to talk about time and the future are maybe 1,000 years old, then that's not much time. So the very concept of the future, the concept of stewardship or responsibility, these will have changed. I think my background is originally, I guess, policy futures. So I've done lots of work with UNESCO and futures literacy. I've spent some time with colleagues in the UK Civil Service doing horizon scanning and foresight there. And I've joined UCL now at the Bartlett, the Institute for Sustainable Heritage, where I'm interested in the relationship between past and future. And when we talk about getting stuff done in a policy context, we assume that the levers we're going to pull remain constant. But we have laws, we have institutions, we have shared values. But when we're thinking about the length of time in which culture changes, these things can't be taken for granted. And so you're really forced to confront the uncertainty that Cornelius is talking about. Next slide. Let's do this. Okay.
We've got 6 slides just to prepare you. And then we'll take questions.
Yeah, this is not 100,000 years long. So this is a plastic agglomerate, this rock. It was from a beach in Hawaii. It's part of an exhibition put together by an artist and a geologist and a marine biologist. And the reason I'm asking you to look at it now is to think about the kind of boundaries that thinking through heritage and thinking through culture allows us to challenge. So I've seen lots of talks so far that talk about human and technology, and they set that against the natural world. And certainly within heritage historically, we've talked about natural heritage and cultural heritage. There's the natural inheritance of this planet and its resources, and then there's the human heritage, the cultural heritage that we make. But this rock is a product of both. And I think colleagues in heritage studies, people who are thinking deeply about what heritage means, are challenging this distinction between natural and cultural, or the distinction between intangible and tangible. That drawing these dividing lines, these separators, is not useful for understanding the place of heritage and culture in understanding our lives. The kind of heritage that constructs our identities, that helps us make sense of the world, is a combination of meaning and dead dinosaurs and all sorts of different aspects of materiality and tangibility and intangibility and ideas all fused together in much the same way that this plastic is fused with this rock. So this was the product of intense heat. It's plastic from the Pacific Gyre, where one of the few places where the world's plastic waste collects. It's drifted into the tip of a volcanic island where locals have made beach fires which have fused the rock into a new form of geological substrate. And so if we're thinking about being stewards of the earth, if we're thinking about being people that care about what we pass on, this is the kind of thing that the kind of changes that we've all come here to imagine, it's a new form of heritage. So when we think about heritage, again, if you're from the UK, or perhaps if you like the UK, you think of Downton Abbey or castles, you know, or knights in armor, or these kind of ideas with heritage. But actually, new forms of heritage are emerging all the time through not just human activity, but through the interaction of human and natural activity. And again, I think one of the contributions that heritage can make to a gathering like this is to think about what new forms are emerging in the world that we have some responsibility for, that we all want to care for and interpret and understand.
Now, earlier in this very room this morning, I was in the Lego session. Maybe some of you were there as well. We all got Lego bits. Now, this is the material from which this conglomerate here is made. So this will be really precious in the future because it manifests the origin of this geological layer that we find in the world. Now, one other thought I had is, you know, UNESCO, you know, you've all heard of World Heritage, and it does now over 1,100 sites around the world, and some continents more than in others, are designated as World Heritage Sites. And all these sites basically effectively are celebrating the different nations where they are located in one way or another. Now, as Richard said, this is a new type of heritage, and maybe if we want to create a world that is based on solidarity between people, that is not just celebrating achievement, but also creating responsibility and understanding of the problems into which we got associated with the Anthropocene, for example, then this is the sort of site that may be a future World Heritage Site that uses a different logic it's distributed, it's not a single temple or something, and it makes us aware of a joint problem on this earth which affects the whole world. You know, all the plastic that comes through the rivers that is deposited in the ocean or on the ocean bed. Some of it ends up on the beaches and so on. So it's a global challenge that a heritage site like this could make us aware of and maybe inspire to act.
Love it. Who's got the next slide? Ah, me again, I think. Okay, so we talk about stewardship. In heritage, it's a really important part of looking after what makes us, what makes the culture that we're in, the culture that it is. It's where we get our identity from. It also is about responsibility and care. And this is, for me, the root of my interest in connecting ideas of heritage with the future, is that it starts with what's important to us. So rather than starting from a kind of objective, technocratic kind of what can be done, let's chart the different options in front of us approach, which has its place, it's very valuable. But instead, what if we explored, starting with what matters to us? What if we started thinking, well, what matters to us first is this population we're responsible for, or the natural world that we have some kind of responsibility for? So this is there anyone from New Zealand here? Okay, great, so I won't get the pronunciation wrong. So this is the Whanganui River in New Zealand. It was originally cared for by the Maori group, the Whanganui, who developed a relationship with it as a person. It was a being, it was a sibling, a cousin, something to which they had a shared responsibility as if they were in a family. That changed when the British arrived, and it was turned into a source of hydroelectric power, a resource to exploit. That relationship was severed. In 2017, the New Zealand Parliament passed an act declaring legal personhood for this river, which allowed it to take a different role in policy discussions. And instead of being an inert, objective resource to which things happened, something approaching the old relationship between the Whanganui group and the river was re-established. Now, obviously, you can't go back. It's not the same. But the reason I'm interested in this particularly now is, it shows two relationships of care that might be interested to those of us coming from a policy background, perhaps, thinking about futures. Well, three, really, I suppose. One is, it shows the possibility of deep change. The idea of granting a river personhood, I think even 20, 30 years ago, most people would think that was some science fiction book and perhaps not even a very successful one. But this is a real statutory moment. This has legal force. This river is as much a person as a corporation. So that's an interesting point to me, that things can change at a deep level. The nature of things can be seen again in a different way. It has a relationship of care between the states and a group that have historically not had their interests well looked after by the state. So there's something there about repair and redress. That there's some, it's a small restorative act, but it's a way of recalibrating the relationship between state government and the Whanganui. And of course, there's a relationship of care between the Whanganui and the river and the surrounding areas now. They're seen much more as something that you relate to, not an inert thing that you have responsibility to protect, but as a living thing that you're in dialogue with and you make decisions alongside through structures of stewardship.
Now, we were earlier talking about new types of heritage, and I think that is one example. We can talk about a post-human heritage in this sense, and I think that is very pertinent in this age where we're concerned about the planet and all the different living beings on this earth. And then, in a way, the river is living too. It's a different kind of heritage that has significance to us today, and probably even more so in the future. Now, the session here is about that the cultural dimension of the future. And culture is a lot about identity. Who are we? But it's also about who are the things and entities and living beings and objects around us. So here, really, with the river as a person, you challenge notions of identity that we are most familiar with. And it challenges, it's a cultural change, really, that we give personhood to non-living beings and non-humans in particular. And that's why this is a good example for the kind of future heritage that we're moving into and that maybe will be more common in the future.
Perhaps I can just
Sure.
Question, because I'm trying, I've been searching for this, you know, Siegfried Gideon, who wrote Time, Space, and Architecture, talks a lot about this idea that balance was broken at one point in time because of the acceleration of industrialization. So I just want to briefly perhaps touch on the point of the severing of this idea of a relationship between us as a temporal society that exists overly into this earth. So I just want to, if possible, just kind of expand on that. It's really interesting, this word severing.
Well, I would say that these relationships are always changing. Since I'm an archaeologist, I have a perspective that doesn't only go 100,000 years into the future, but also 100,000 years or more into the past. And I think you see relationships between people and the natural environment and human resources changing all the time. So yes, happens in modern time also, and yes, that we talk about the personhood in this case is also an expression of another change of relationships and how we define our place as human beings in the natural world. So in that sense, it's a change, but nothing completely different than what has been part of human history for a very long time.
Yeah, I'd echo the length of time that's relevant, I think. There's certainly a narrative around this divide, and it's very easy to kind of put on a serious face and lament, you know, our lost innocence, and you know, talk about a time when we were together in harmony. And definitely, historically, there's a, you know, the kind of the modern era did recalibrate the relationship between human culture and the rest of the world. The introduction of scientific management for forests, for example, in the 1600s and 1700s, the kind of the use of abstract ideas like maps and grids to understand the world. Replacing being in it and so on. So that's a thing that happened. But if I told you a story about a rich, teeming rainforest that was razed to the ground for agriculture, you might assume that was part of that same story. But that's England, that's the UK, that's the hills that have been bare since Neolithic times. They didn't clear that as part of some kind of modernist industrial process. That was them as a group using resources that were available to them in the same way that bears fish for salmon, or mosquitoes like people. I think, for me personally, one of the things I'm trying to entertain in myself is to kind of put to one side this idea of there being a divide between human and nature, and thinking instead that actually we ought to think of ourselves as being part of a natural world, just a very complex part, perhaps a part that's so complex it's hard to see out beyond it, to see yourself as part of nature. Certainly that helps me feel better about plastics and microplastics. You know, that we have, I just get very stressed when I think about the difference between human and nature, and something that helps me feel better is to see we are all complex processes in a huge complex system. And the divide between human and nature is something that is a historical moment. It's a rhetoric, a discourse that is available to us. It makes a lot of sense of lots of the world, but it's something we can put down as well as take up. Would be my off-the-cuff response, I don't know. That was a great question. It's made me think.
Thank you.
Right, here's a map that is a little bit small for you to read, but let me explain what you see. Talking about change, this is the projected change of the human temperature niche by 2070, so almost 50 years into the future. And I should add, it's a from a scientific paper. It's a rather pessimistic view, but nevertheless, it is within the realm of possibilities of how the human temperature niche. So that's the area with mean annual temperature between 11 and 15 degrees Celsius. How this will change over the next decades. And I think what you can see is that the area where of the human temperature niche will in the northern hemisphere move northward, and in the southern hemisphere move southwards. It's the darker areas, basically. So these are the areas where it will be more beneficial, but it will be easier to conduct agriculture and for people to make a living in direct contact with the natural world. Now, So this is a kind of what is anticipated today for the future. Now, if we want to take care of people's needs and maybe enhance their resilience and create a solidarity, then it may be that common understandings of cultural heritage are actually a liability in this, because very often cultural heritage is, as we know it, is part of the of national romanticism, about 200 years old, and it is connected to territory. So it's not just you belong to your fellow beings in a community, but also you belong to a particular place or a particular area. Now, if people have to move because they cannot survive in the areas where they have been maybe farmers or fishers before, then that means they need to leave their own territory, but they also need to live in somebody else's territory. And so I think that we may, in the future, people may require an understanding of heritage that is more based maybe on intangible aspects, on the traditions, on what they do and what they think, what they appreciate, more so than about territory. And this may help us to avoid some bloody conflicts about who owns the land, who is supposed to live there and to call this their own land. So this is one of the challenges that I think we can anticipate for the decades ahead, and cultural heritage is a key here, because it's very often, it's not just political boundaries, but it's also heritage boundaries, that the history of a particular group belongs to a particular place. And then it's gonna be problematic in a future where not everybody can survive in the areas in which they are now.
I'm glad we're in such a calming environment to think about such violent futures, but you're right. I think one of the things that is really important to me in my conception of the relationship between the future and heritage is being really clear that heritage is a thing that's invented in the present, that calling things heritage and allocating resources to them, celebrating some aspects of culture over others, for example, these are choices that are made. They're informed by genuine feelings and emotions and history, but they're choices that people make. And that, to me, gives me hope. Speaking from a European perspective and particularly perhaps a British perspective, there are lots of aspects of our heritage which it's unhelpful to cling on to. It's not useful. But the fact that heritage is something that's constructed, whether you're a new nation or an old nation, and that's done intentionally, that means that there's the chance to construct some kind of common, some genuinely common human heritage that allows us to think about those bonds of care to each other that will give us the kind of solidarity and resilience that we'll need to face this kind of upheaval. And I don't think this is something that's going to happen on a specific Tuesday. This is a gradual process, but it's one that I think if we're conscious and mindful about how it's happening, then we can perhaps do the cultural work to equip us to have the kind of solid identity that will allow us to do this without feeling insecure and threatened and in need of competition, and we can work together. Okay, so this is Moss. I like Moss. This is, actually Moss is a great example of different populations working together, but that's a biological side note. This photograph comes from a wetlands project in Northern Ireland, which is a community-led effort to reorient the local community towards the peatland that they live near. That in the lifetimes of most of the people on this project and their parents, the peat was seen as a fuel, as a resource. It's one of the most carbon-emitting forms of fuel. It takes millions of years to form, and it's not quite dead dinosaurs, but it takes a long time to form. It's very hard to make, it's very quick to use it up. And so this project is part of a way of not just saying you can't do that anymore, but reorienting the relationship that people have towards this place so that they learn to care for it, or they're able to give expression to the care they already feel for it in a way that's actually tangible and pragmatic and will lead to the area becoming, a stronger element in our response to climate change.
Now, as I think has been pointed out, or maybe it wasn't conversations we had, that culture is also about language. And I propose that it is about more languages than five, as we heard this morning in one of the keynotes. And one of the languages that, one of the reasons why languages are important is that they have a particular set of metaphors that make sense of the larger world in specific terms that are unique often to the particular way of thinking, making sense of the world in a particular community. Now, this, and I'm thinking here in terms of communication, how what Richard has said is expressed through the metaphor of this moss being in somebody's hand. A tahand om något, as it's called in Swedish, is the ultimate metaphor for care about something. You can really see, I think most of us understand the gesture here, is something in their hand. It could be a little animal or some treasure that you take care of. And I think this is a key if you want to understand each other, that we understand the metaphors that we all use. And if we want to have a common purpose, we need to use a language that is sort of common to all of us, a metaphorical language in this case. And there's one other image I was thinking about, which I don't even need to show on the slides here, because if I mention it to you, you'll all have it in your mind. And that's the Earth seen from space. Now, these are the pictures from the late 60s and early 70s, especially, that changed the human beings' relationship to the planet. That's the origin of the environmental movement, is this picture of the planet Earth, how fragile it looks from the people on this, well, it wasn't the space station, from the moon, on the moon trips. So I think very important to think about metaphors and language and how we communicate with each other and create common purposes. Right.
Actually, I remember the image which was put of the blue mark.
Yes.
On the whole Earth catalog.
Yeah.
Which then inspired Steve Jobs.
Right.
Patagonia, the brand.
Yeah.
And a whole movement that came out of it. So it's kind of an interesting reframing of how image reframes a particular thing.
Exactly. And it's a language that is common to all of us. We can all sort of relate to that. It's not sort of a particular, it's not one of the five languages, so to speak. Right, and let's stay with the natural imagery. Now, what is that? Now, actually, I was on an excavation 2 years ago now, and this is a soil sample from this Iron Age site, so it's about 2,000 years old. And the soil sample was taken, and this bag was sitting somewhere. And then after a while, some grass started to grow in it. And the director of the excavation and all the other people said, oh, you know, this is nothing special. This is just a soil standing sample that had been standing too long. It's just who cares? But I was disagreeing. I said, no, this is not just some bizarre thing that grows out of this. This is a different temporality that we see at place here. And this is something we should take, the grass, we should take more seriously than we normally do, because it shows how resilient the beings are that are in the soil that archaeologists are studying. And it shows that it's not the only way to deal with an archaeological site by taking samples and trying to reconstruct and recover a previous reality up to the extent that we can reconstruct it. But here are processes in place that are about ecological regeneration, that are about resilience, as I said, that have their own legitimacy. And as we started to think in those terms, at the excavation site, we dig through soil, through humus, we cut away roots, we throw out stones, there are lots of spiders and insects that we sort of throw away or kill or do not put in our hands, do not care for. And I think that is a pity. I think this is something we could change in archaeology in order to show respect for a different kind of temporality, one that is that is part of the natural world already. So one could say that archaeology is not just about reconstructing the heritage from the Iron Age, in this case, from a past reality, but it could also be about creating together with the soil, with the grass, with all the beings, with the roots, with the humus, to build a joint future heritage that unites natural and cultural evidence from different periods. So that's a completely different way of appreciating an archaeological site, and it's one that links to a temporality that is continuous, that is not just datable to one age, but it's one that unites everything and that is outside the cultural sphere and sort of ongoing. It started in Sweden after the Ice Age, and it will continue until some other major geological event that will stop this from continuing. Maybe the next Ice Age or whatever will come. So this is an alternative to the practicalities of archaeology, a challenge to the very methodology of excavation.
What I find so fantastic about this picture, back to your point about the metaphor, is that it illustrates for me a really I find valuable concept, which I think is very pertinent to heritage and heritage futures, which is the idea of latent futures. That we're used to talking about the future as over there on some kind of line, at least if you're in a kind of a Western or modernist kind of culture. So we're here and we will get to the future, or it will come and sweep over us, but there's this kind of spatialization. And actually what's going on around us is lots of processes are unfolding. Some of them are empirically evident, some of them we can't see. And in this case, you know, you couldn't see the processes that would lead to the grass, but they were going on. When you picked the soil up, they were going on anyway. They were latent. They were imminent in the present moment. And that's also going on with the plastic, which looks much less inert than the biological soil and the grass that sprung from it. But the plastic is also exchanging atoms with the environment. There are certain bonds that are weakening over time that will lead to discoloration, that will lead to a change in the atmosphere in the room that the bag is kept in. And these processes are also always ongoing, and that's where futures come from. That around us right now, in a world in process, the future is with us, which is a useful metaphor for challenging the kind of linear approach, I think, personally.
Well, and there we are. These were our six images, and I have no idea what time it is, but I think we have some time for questions, do we?
I think it's 2:23.
Perfect.
So, you can open it up.
You know a little bit on what Heritage Futures is all about. What are your queries?
We already have the first question.
Down here as well.
Do we have a walking microphone? Well, shall we start with her, maybe?
Yes.
Yeah. Why don't you?
Hello to all three of you, and thank you very much for this very inspiring session. My question was, how do you deal with the trade-offs we face? Today, we are in a world that is with limited resources, and we have present needs, but sometimes these present needs are so important that we can't make the choice between the present needs and the rights for the future generations to inherit a sustainable planet, especially in young countries. I will just take an example. In Algeria, every summer, there is massive fires that destroy nature, and water is a limited resource here. So the choice that policymakers made was to use water that was very limited at the time for the population. But at the same time, you harm, when doing that, the right for future generations to inherit this water. So what frameworks would you use, what tools to decide about these trade-offs that we need, this tension between present needs and future generations'
rights? Can I maybe suggest, in the interest of time, that we hear a few more people and then we do a collective response? Is that okay?
Okay, I was just going to say very quickly, actually, and I think they're going to be quite different.
Which means I disagree.
Oh, well, if I just get on, I'll be very quick, just because I think this might get lost in some of the others, but just, I think that's a fantastic example, and it's existential. And I think that what's valuable to me about going to CARE, and by CARE I mean the kind of philosophy of Carol Gilligan and Annette Bayer from the 70s, Maria Puig de la Bella Casa today, that there's a lot of thought being given about CARE, that it is okay to focus on real existing relationships. And I don't agree that future generations have the same rights that we do. I don't agree that abstract people extended millennia into the future are just as important as we do. I don't know them. I also think, without any disrespect, that my family is more important to me. I have not met your family and I don't know them, you know? I wish them well. But it's it's okay to say we care about people having drinking water now and to prioritize that. And that the language of care and doing the best by the people that matter to you now means that it's okay. Now, another thing, I'm thinking about Caitlin's work around decay and loss. And there are lots of people in heritage who are very used to thinking about the fact we need to let things go, and that it's just not possible to keep everything and take it with us. And if you think about things unfolding over time, that means saying goodbye, that means loss, that means death, as well as keeping everything coming with us. That was as quick as I could be.
Now we've got two more people waiting. We hear them first.
Thank you very much.
Sorry, well, he starts, he was first.
I think our moderator has a cue.
Okay, but he's already got the microphone.
Okay. Shall I go? You started your first slide with the future will be cultural. Earlier today, in the earlier session, we get this, someone said that the future will be about climate. Earlier today, said the future will be about tech. So on our future radar, we have like this three aspects. And some of cultural habits, and especially intangible cultural heritage, are affecting and is affected by climate. Plus, having new modern technologies and AI are affecting also cultural habits and their uniqueness. Misleading narrative, cultural narratives are being spread thanks to the UNESCO, but there's a lot of cultural heritage that need to be documented, but there's no there's a limited time. Where do we stand between all of these aspects, and how do we really foresight a good future?
Yes, thank you, because I think there is a central question about this. If you have an anticipation projection, and the question for both, and thank you very much for your session. Do you think that if 50 years, regarding to what we have learned in other sessions about technological change, culture would be still the property of human being? In 50 years, had robots, artificial intelligence, the definition, do we need a new definition, concept of culture, which was still the property of human being? First question. The second thing about foresight, what will be the next legal or regulation to protect the future heritage for all of human, but inhabitant of our planet? Because culture is basically dynamic. So that's my question linked to your question. Thank you. And to make an effort about anticipation to change the concept of culture, which until now is a property of us.
Yeah, I will be
very briefly.
Yeah, so I think my answer is technology is culture. I also think, as I was saying before, tangible, intangible, natural, human, tech, culture, whatever, they're mutually constitutive categories. It's not one that is prior to the other. I think any analysis shows that they do all interact. Any futurist will know that, I think, or live that. I think in terms of the culture, I'm all for trying to have a more than human definition of culture. I don't believe AGI will happen. I think AI is a crowning human achievement. I think it's made by people and a lot of dead dinosaurs and a lot of power and a lot of material stuff. It's a huge assemblage of lots of different things, but I don't think and maybe a robot will come and tell me to apologize to you in 50 years because I was wrong. But for the moment, I don't think robot culture is a thing.
And I would basically agree with you. So I think we should challenge the divisions between climate and technology and culture. And I think the point of this session was that culture is a dimension that goes through everything, that affects all these dimensions, and maybe that we haven't heard enough at this conference and different sessions. So that's the point. And yes, there are culture is dynamic and it changes, and it has changed as we look back, and it will change in the future. We did make reference to the post-human, and yes, robots, there's also discussion on whether they produce culture and how they will be part of heritage, absolutely.
You know, my name is Richard Xu. I work in China and across a few countries in Asia. I've followed UNESCO heritage, been part of it for many years. And Richard, I agree in part what you said about some of the heritage of the past needs to be moved forward. We have seen more and more heritage kept, villages, society behind, not growing and dead end, because they want to hold on to that heritage so much. And because of tourism, because of other reasons, government do not want them to grow forward. We've seen part of that. And with 7-8 years following UNESCO World Heritage, I experienced something a few months ago that I'd like to share. Is heritage in emergency? Because of all the beautiful talks of heritage, beautiful visits, and the Love for Aga Khan Awards and the foundation, I spent time in southern Turkey and seeing the devastation of 11 villages, 50 to 100,000 people. And I'm looking at the idea of emergency of heritage. There is an organization called CER, Culture Emergency Response. And I'm wondering, with all the knowledge of heritage, why don't we find a way to also touch the low-hanging fruits, the ones we can really make impact, not 100 years from now, but 10,000, 100,000 people that need to survive now because their cultures are not getting along, because it's impossible to build because there's cultural differences and people are going to winter in the next few months. So more and more, I suddenly become much more thinking about emergency and relief rather than culture for beauty of culture's sake.
Just comment. Just going back to the gentleman who was just talking about at 100,000s, 10,000s of years. To me, it's culture. Everybody talks about and heritage. When they do speak about that, it's like they're going back. But I think that's something that is now and is in the future. And future is the past. So my question is, how old is the past and how old will be the future? Are they equal?
My question is actually linked to Darius' one. It's probably, if you want, I can ask it. Sort of maybe they can answer all three together. Thank you so much for all this. So it's linked to the past and the present. So if you have to say a few things, you know, everything is moving and shifting and in a dynamic of change. And if you had to link two things that we are losing about our heritage and culture, we shouldn't be, or we should think about, what are they? One or two things. And then if you go into the future, what are the seeds that are in that little earth that we should be looking at, you know, that are going to grow into the grass?
I've been instructed that we must end in 2 minutes. So, so sorry.
Okay, but maybe just very one quick response.
Yeah, please.
Sorry, just one question. I'm going to make it short and sweet. So where do we draw a line between preserving the cultural heritage in its original form and allowing it to evolve over time to meet, to reflect the current needs and values? Thank you.
We'll maybe allow you to answer these two questions, and then maybe that's after we end the session and we have a one-on-one.
Sure. Well, I think these two questions actually go together. Often there are very real needs that communities have, and they may involve heritage. And yes, there are all sorts of situations where we feel that things are going wrong and are not having the effects that we want to. And I should say, I do not represent UNESCO, and I don't speak in the name of UNESCO, but it's precisely the reason, this emotional attachment to heritage, the great significance that it has for people's lives, that's precisely the reason why we should be concerned about what sort of heritage do we want to leave behind. What is the heritage that we think we can benefit people in the future? And I'm not talking 100,000 years in the future now. I think our children and grandchildren, what is the heritage that they will benefit from most? And this doesn't doesn't substitute the question you raised. Of course, we need to be concerned about the present as well. But it's another dimension that is just as significant how can we create a better life for people in the next few decades ahead. I think that's also of a primary significance.
Yeah.
Thank you very much, everyone.
Okay.
Thank you.